We're going to talk about all of the things. And I just want to set some ground rules that first, even if we have different opinions, let's please try to seek first to understand and then to be understood. We do not all have the same outlooks, perspectives, but everyone's perspective is valid. And I just want to make sure that we are coming here with an open heart and open mind so that we can have a conversation about what's truly needed to make the crown jewel of our city, one of the many as I see it, accessible for everybody. Is that okay? Thumbs up? Okay. So as I stated earlier, there's been a proposal from some city staff that has the support of Council President Bass to implement parking meters at Lake Merritt to address some of the issues that folks have been experiencing. The parking meters will be revenue generating and go to fund some services potentially from the proposal that's coming before the council on the 21st. And I wanna hear what you all think about it. If you've been on city council meetings or at some of the PRAC meetings, then you may have heard residents calling in. Some Black vendors at the lake find this proposal to be racist and problematic. There are neighbors who are like, get this started as soon as possible. And then some of our city staff just want to see this as a potential way to bring in additional revenue and make it more accessible to turnover parking for people who are visiting the lake. I did raise my personal issue around having a survey with so many people weighing in on the survey that didn't necessarily want to see parking meters as a solution, but I want to hear what you all have to say today. And so I'm going to be collecting responses up until the June 21st meeting so I can craft a solution in my brain that works for as many people as possible. So I do want to acknowledge that Princess Allen is here. She gave us the lovely serenade at the beginning of the meeting, but Princess Allen is also on the Parks and Rec Advisory Committee. Is it committee or commission? Committee.
Commission.
Commission. I also have my District 3 staff here. Jyoti is up there handling all of the behind the scenes work for us, but has also put the survey together. It's on social media, making sure people are aware of what's going on in the office. I want to say thank you. And then I also have my chief of staff here who probably will sing us out at the end of the meeting. Tanya Love, I want to give a shout out there. And also to the volunteers who are helping make sure that this is a secure space. So Reese, I want to give a shout out to you as well. So without further ado, let's get into the conversation. Princess, do you feel comfortable framing the position that the PRAC put forward so that we can give people a full understanding of what's being proposed?
Yes, definitely. So I want to thank you again, Councilwoman Fife. I am the chair of PRAC. However, I'm attending as an individual concerned citizen. But I will, because the PRAC was not aware of this meeting, so I have no thoughts on behalf of the PRAC necessarily, but I can frame PRAC's position, the recommendation that we put forth to City Council, and the recommendation that we asked Joe DeVries to include is that the 100% of the revenues actually goes back onto parks and parks programming. And I provided a breakdown of that information to Joe DeVries in a sense of, I'm looking for my notes right now with the exact breakdown, but essentially we divided the 100% of the revenue into thirds roughly, and to say, the first portion will go into park maintenance, as park maintenance is stipulated with Measure Q. Let me repeat that. So the Measure Q ad hoc committee from PRAC worked with the Lake Merritt ad hoc committee. And so we said the larger portion of the fund should go into park maintenance. That's just a general blanket park maintenance of all of our city parks. Another third should go towards lighting the crosswalks along Lake Shore Avenue. Those are the, there are intersections along Lakeshore that are not lit. They're not flashing yellow lights like there are on Grand Avenue. And so we said funding should go towards making sure lights are installed on all of those crosswalks. We identified them. And then thirdly, we said a portion of the fund should go into the Park Stewards Program, because right now the Park Steward Program pays for one full-time supervisor and I believe like 15 part-time FTEs, and those individuals will pair up and they will rotate around the city's parks, but only Friday through Sunday. And so with a dedicated funding stream for Park Stewards, we hope to have in like full-time Park Stewards for all of our parks to be there Monday through Sunday, every day of the week. And we also said that the parking meter program that Joe DeVries and his department has put together should be ran as a pilot with a 6-month review of metrics. And the reason why we're specifically asking for a 6-month review of metrics is because right now we have, the PRAC has yet to receive hardcore statistics about this parking meter parking plan around the lake. I can say that we know residents are the most ticketed group of those who park around the lake, but I know that because I have a Measure Q ad hoc committee member who works for OCDOT as well. And he's just told me that, but I've not seen the hardcore statistics. So what Joe DeVries wants to do has no sound evidence. I've yet to see the evidence within statistics and the metrics. And so that's why the PRAC is asking for specific metrics. If Joe DeVries' group says this is a traffic issue because there are triple and double parking, well, let's get the reports from parking enforcement to see, are we still ticketing double and triple parking? If Joe DeVries is saying that first responders can't get through the traffic of Lakeshore, well, then let's have a metric be the first responder reports. If Joe DeVries is saying that the bus system, AC Transit, has to be detoured and they cannot get through, or that they are running out of delay because of the congestion on Lakeshore, well, then let's check the bus routes and their records on timeliness and how on schedule their buses are after these parking meters are put in place. And if we're saying that the parking meters will provide more access and minimize the violence around the lake, then let's monitor the police reports coming from OPD and the arrest reports. And so that's why PRAC is asking for this additional 6-month review of metrics, because then the metrics will support the theories behind this parking meter plan. Right now, it is a theory to most of us because we have not seen the data. And my point from PRAC, I can go into more detail about how this all came to us. It did not come to us very timely, and it didn't come to us very crystal clear. The waters were a little muddy. So we were reacting to it versus proactively planning for this. And that's why at this point, PRAC has said, well, if you're going to go through this plan, then we want to recoup 100% of the revenues back into parks. And that is PRAC's position. And that is the recommendation that PRAC approved at our May meeting. And we took to council at the, I think it was May 17th council meeting. And that's what I can say from PRAC's point of view, Councilwoman.
Thank you for sharing that. And because I want to hear more than talk, I'm going to recognize the hands that are raised. So I do want to recognize that I see James Van with your hand up. So James, go ahead. And thank you for being here.
Thank you, Councilmember Fife. I I can give a little bit more history of going back to 2001 when the planning for the revitalization of the Lake Merritt parks and waterworks, waterways, and the complete reconstruction of East 12th Street into Lake Merritt Boulevard was done, and how the parking that exists around Lake Merritt came to be. I'm part of a group called Coalition of Advocates for Lake Merritt, and we, Governor Jerry Brown had essentially committed the parking lot of the Henry J. Kaiser Convention Center to the Archdiocese to build the new cathedral that ultimately got built at Harrison and Grand Avenue. My group opposed that, and ultimately we got City Council to put out the development of the south end of the lake into an RFP, so more bidders could bid on what should happen there. My group proposed the design for Lake Merritt Boulevard, which as it exists today. And there were three firms that bid it. The Catholic Archdiocese was so certain their plan had been assured by the governor, by the mayor, that they essentially didn't compete. So the City Council, we selected the design of the group that I'm part of, Coalition of Advocates for Lake Merritt, and instructed the design consultant who had been contracted to do the Lake Merritt improvement plan up to all through Lakeshore and around Lake Park and the around the Cameron Stanford to this Cameron Stanford House, but the planning stopped at the south end of the lake because the mayor was involved in conversations with the Archdiocese, as I said. Anyway, when we designed the Lake Merritt and the council instructed the designers to work with my group in the design we had put forward that the council had selected. And one of the recommendations we made was that the redevelopment of the parklands around the lake would be so transformed. The new amphitheater, the new landscaping all around the lake, the widened pathways, walkways, and running paths, that the Lake Merritt would become more than just a City of Oakland highlight, but would become a regional attraction. And we recommended that in that it was going to be new regional attraction, that people should have the opportunity to enjoy the lake, to come and visit and picnic and enjoy the lake. And we recommended a 3-hour parking limit. And that's what exists at the lake now. The signs around the lake do permit for 3-hour parking. There are no meters, but it's 3 hours. And now over the years, a number of things do change. The situation around the cul-de-sac at 1200 Lakeshore at the end of Lakeshore Avenue. A lot of problems arose around there, and the whole incidence of people beginning to set up commercial activities on the lake and so on Lakeshore Avenue, and now Grand had not happened at that time. So a lot of things has happened since. So it did deserve relooking at, but the early planning for the redevelopment and the beautification of Lake Merritt and the lake parks around the lake, did not envision a short-term limited parking, but an opportunity for people to be attracted to the lake and to have time to enjoy it with their families and so forth. And that's how the three-hour limit got established. And now this city is being asked, the community is being asked to reduce that and just make it a one-hour limit with parking meters. My group hasn't really discussed this, but I attended the meeting because I'd like to hear what people's thoughts are. And I thought it might be interesting to just throw that in as to how the parking that exists at the lake today did get installed. And thank you.
Thank you, James. Lots to cover. And I do want to say we don't have a lot of time to probably get into everything, but I want to hear as many people give their feedback as possible. I want to recognize Cyrus, who also has their hand up. So Cyrus, please go ahead.
Hi, thanks. As you can see, I'm at the lake right now. I live by the lake. I live two streets behind Grand. And what I love about the lake is that I could come and see everyone from all over Oakland, and even from outside of Oakland, like come and gather and have a good time. And it's a joyous place, it's an alive place. I like seeing people like selling things and kind of like having different kind of economies like pop up. I appreciate it. I understand that the people at other parts of the lake where it is maybe like super loud in front of their house, or like violence can happen. And I understand that that's an issue for people. And I don't want to wave that away as a concern, but I do really love seeing anyone, the diversity that is the Bay, that is Oakland, represented at the lake. And it would really, really suck to have that go away. It would just change the character so much. And I don't know, I appreciate it. And I understand that things change, but I would really hate to have something like a parking meter at the lake, like harm people's ability to enjoy it. And I also think that with living around the lake comes some expectation of that it is a busy kind of happening place, and that that you will have, like, it comes with that kind of understanding to live around the lake. And I don't think it's a reasonable expectation to expect to live like right on Lake Merritt and like have a very quiet neighborhood. And like, if you wanted that, there are more affordable places, in fact, to live that are not that way, you know. I don't know, that's my thoughts on it. And I appreciate living at the lake and what it provides.
Thank you, Cyrus. So before I ask the challenging question that I want people to provide feedback to, I want to ask, does anyone else want to weigh in with their thoughts and perspectives? Brianne, am I saying that correctly?
It's Brianne, but thank you.
Brianne.
So I'm an Oakland native. I grew up in North Oakland, but obviously it got too expensive. Moved to Fruitvale just so my place can finally afford something at the lake with my multiple jobs. And so to Cyrus and I believe James' point, there's the expectation that if you live on a lake that like you're here because it is lively, right? Like I live right on the Cleveland Cascade Stairs. There's a guy who plays his music super loud almost, you know, a couple of days a week because he's working out, but he's been coming here for like 20 years to do that. So I think it's when I think about like, oh, they're saying the meters would lead to less crime. They're essentially saying because Black people won't be here. And so for me, being a Black person in Oakland, like I'm never gonna be okay with that. even if it would make the lake more quiet, like that's not why I moved here. I moved here because I can hear the motorcycles, because I can hear people at the lake, because I can walk down and run into anybody. And so I think with this proposal, it's changing the culture of Oakland. Like, this is why we're here. I remember like going to festival at the lake and everything like that. And that's the vibe that we should keep, the culture that we should keep. It shouldn't be, the lake should not only be accessible to people who live in the area or can afford to live in the area. It shouldn't just be accessible just to people who still live in Oakland, because we know a lot of folks have been pushed out of Oakland. So I just want to echo what the other two gentlemen were saying about like just making sure that the lake is accessible to everybody. So these parking meters, I mean, it would make parking much worse for my family when they come and visit me as well. So it would have a negative impact on those of us who live in the area, but it would also have a huge impact on those who may have been pushed out, but still come back to the lake as like, you know, this is where I can still come back to. This is still my part of Oakland. So I just want to echo what the other two gentlemen said as well.
All right. Does anyone else want to share? Thank you, Breon. Okay. I don't see any hands. So I need you all to help me think this through, right? So you all are my think tank in this particular moment, because there are people with various perspectives who live at the lake. So whose perspective has more weight, right? That's what, and I'm not taking a position, but I want to throw out something right now. There's activity that is occurring at the lake right now that is problematic at times. Is there disagreement with that perspective? Does anybody disagree? Some of the things that I've witnessed when I've been called by constituents, and I will go out to the lake when I get their call if I'm not in a meeting. And I've been called about this one in particular open air drug market. I've been called when people are doing donuts on the grass at, you know, at the Lake Merritt by the library. And I've also been called when vehicles can't get through and drive through the streets on Grand. I'm consistently called by people on Bellevue around loud music late into the night, well past 10 p.m. So if you all had to switch places with me, what would you tell those constituents? Kina, am I saying that correctly?
It's Kenna that Kenna. Kina raised. I just want to go back to uplift what Princess said at the beginning, Councilwoman, which was simply that there doesn't seem to be data that this is the intervention that will have the desired impact. And so I would really ask for any examples anywhere else, right? It doesn't have to be here in Oakland. It could be from Minnesota, right? I don't care where the data is coming from, as long as we could actually see that parking meters result in a lessening of an open air drug market. I would point to the Tenderloin to say probably not, right? I would look at, do parking meters impact murder rates, and look at parts of New York and say probably not, right? There's a lot that I think we're hinging this on that, as somebody who is very data driven, I don't see evidence for this particular intervention. And it's great that we're talking about having more stewards. It's wonderful that we're looking to create more funding for our parks, but that's not what is driving this change. So my response would simply be, would you not want us to find the right solution to get the desired impact, as opposed to just doing something for no good reason?
Tanya Love is my chief of staff. Tanya, can we talk about, okay, so now I'm gonna be a little more forthcoming with some of my thoughts around this, because Kenna just said it. And Tanya can back me up on this, because we talk about this, we've been talking about this since it came before the council. Is this approach congruent with the issue? Do parking meters stop donuts? Do parking meters stop double parking? because it a lot of the activity, and I was rereading through the policy and the proposal about making Lake Merritt safe. And I've been struggling because I don't believe that this is a congruent approach with the problems that people bring to me. And so now I'm sharing my personal perspective. And I do believe something should happen. I just don't know if this is that, which is why I want to talk to people, talk to more people like directly, because I do want to do something. But if people are engaged in illegal activity, then I don't think having them do something legal would be the way to get us out of the illegal activity. But I'm struggling with that. So, Princess.
Thank you, Councilwoman. So speaking as a concerned citizen, mm-hmm. I do not think the parking management plan will minimize the illegal activity we are seeing around the lake. That is my God honest opinion. I don't know what is driving wanting to meter the lake, because for those of you, Councilwoman Fife referred to a survey that was done. This survey was done last spring, roughly 2,500 people, the majority of which were not people of color. And there's I have a master's in public policy and I've taken a program evaluation. It was a bad survey by policy standards, but they took whatever little responses they got and they decided to make it gold or make it the gold standard. And the question of parking meters was already on that survey. So this parking meter idea came from somewhere, I don't know where, it predates me on PRAC. But I do not think that putting parking meters in place is going to solve the issues, the illegal activity and the dangerous activities that we are seeing around the lake. And when I say dangerous activities, not just the illegal sales and the donuts in the streets, but the traffic congestion. And so this group, the group that's leading it, they're saying, their rhetoric is we want to provide access to the park. Some commissioners have said, you need to phrase this as a safety issue because everyone can get behind wanting Lake Merritt to be safe and wanting to have a safe and enjoyable time at the lake. And if we approach it from that respect, if you meter the lake and you put the money into resources that are going to provide safety measures around the lake, then that makes sense. But if you're saying it's to create access, then I do have to question access for who? And I'm not saying that the narrative of they want that there are people who want to deter Black people and people of color from the lake, and that's their reasoning behind this parking plan. I have no evidence supporting that, so I can't say if that's true or not. I know I'm a Black woman. I know I don't go to the lake as often as I used to go to the lake, and I have to sit in meetings talking about it. So I see both sides of it, but I'm just saying this theory of creating access is not, I don't think it's a true theory from as a concerned individual citizen. I personally do not want the parking meters there because I do think it will deter people from just everyday park goers from going. I don't think I would go to the lake as much if you say you're going to meter the entire lake. I don't know if I'm going to go as often as I'm already going. And I've cut back on going to the lake since the pandemic started. That's just my own personal concern. I'm concerned about the safety, the illegal activity, the traffic congestion, but I also know how to take the back streets and be okay with it. But I don't think that these parking meters are going to solve the issue. These are issues that we are seeing across the entire city. And I think that's the root cause. It's like, well, what's making it spur across the entire city? Because what's happening across the entire city is spilling over to Lake Merritt. Hmm. I'm sorry, Councilwoman. I don't have a solution. I wrote some possible things in the survey response, but my solution is probably not going to be a favored solution, because I feel like certain enforcement bodies should be on the job doing their job wholeheartedly.
And that was my next question, because it seems like the issues that people are raising are issues of enforcement, because there are already rules like, you know, you shouldn't be double parking, you shouldn't be blocking intersections or driveways. You shouldn't be doing donuts on the grass. That's very expensive to repair for the city of Oakland. You shouldn't be dumping illegally or just leaving trash. So we have a municipal code and rules to govern how to engage at the park, and that's just not happening. So to me, if a rule is broken, there has to be some kind of consequence or enforcement for that. The city council is not the body to enforce the law, right? That is currently, as it stands, the police department. So if the police and the police department, and I'm not making a judgment, I know all the people want to come out the woodwork and say, to say Carol is pushing for anarchy because the police, she's saying the police are not enforcing. That's what they told me. I've had a number of OPD captains tell me I'm not sending my officers to the lake to enforce the law because we have other critical things to attend to. The public wants us to address violent crime. The things that are happening at the lake are not violent crimes, and we are not going to do that. So I'm asking you all another question. With the structures and systems that we have in place, the police department is the law enforcement arm of this municipality. If the law enforcement arm is not going to enforce the law, what do you all think should happen in its place? James, I see your hand raised.
Thank you, Councilmember. I think the move to parking meters, short-term parking meters, was kind of hurried and premature. As some of the comments have said, I don't think it came from a rational analysis and a data-driven study that this would in fact do what some people are saying it will do. The problems that have been enunciated and those you've been asked to come and observe or witness, it seems to me, they should be attended to. I don't believe that most of the problems are matters that the police should be brought into. So what I'm thinking is, maybe there are some incremental ways to adopt some changes that can be observed and to see how they work over time and to maybe increase them if they seem to work well. And the kinds of things I'm thinking about are some of the things that have been mentioned. Bringing in park stewards, they used to be called rangers, and especially on the weekend, having a crew of rangers there, people in uniform, in some kind of uniform, and that does have an effect. Putting meters at the crosswalks to help people cross more safely seems to me should certainly be done. Improving the lighting, if that's necessary to do. Expanding the macro program to have macro, I don't know what the people who work in the macro program will call, but I would like to see them at the lake on weekends, at least on trial basis, to see if engaging with people who are involved in aberrant behaviors and by talking in calm ways can minimize some of that behavior. Yes, these are people who are being trained in that kind of interaction. And I think those are some of the things I would like to see implemented before the city rushes to the expensive job of metering the entire lake and making people feel unwelcome that they've got, I mean, you can't walk the lake in an hour. It takes at least an hour and 15 minutes to walk the lake. So many people come to the lake to walk it or to jog it and so forth. And I want people to continue to do that. I want to see them continue to enjoy it. I want to see them continue to picnic and have access to the beauty of the lake. And so I'd like to see some of those kinds of measures put into effect first before we try to attack it through reducing the parking. Thank you.
Thank you, James. And I also want to share for the record that I'm not trying to give a political analysis on anarchism. I just said that tongue in cheek a little earlier, but that is what people say about me, that because I'm an anarchist, communist, socialist, I want all of the city to fall apart. So I'm just saying that's a little off, but you know, that's neither here nor there. I do want to hear from Joanna. You left a comment in the chat about parking permits for individuals who live around the lake. Could you say a little more about that?
Yeah, I've lived here. I'm on Lakeside and Madison. I've been here for 15 years now. And that this part of lake, like I can't get an F permit. So that means I got to park on the street. And so moving the car every 2 hours is one thing. But if this were to be mirrored, now I would have to pay to have my car on the street, and I would have to pay every 2 hours. So I don't know which is more expensive or which process is cheaper to get through. Like, why is this particular section not allowed to have an F permit when literally the buildings across the street from me are? It just like, it's not logical to me, and it hasn't made sense for 15 years, but that's the state of affairs. So I'm just curious, like, how will that impact folks in other areas who can't get the permit to be able to park? And will the, and if the metering does happen, will it acknowledge the F permits for those who have them? Like, I'm just kind of curious about that, but that's kind of where my head was at. And I know Kenna was saying the same thing.
Kenna and Joanna, can you send me your emails in the chat so I can follow up with you about those F permits? Because that is a very important question. And I haven't heard that addressed, and I will bring that to our Department of Transportation as well as Joe DeVries around that particular issue. That's something I want to get clarity on too. So thank you for raising it. And thank you to myself for asking the question. So I'm going to save my question. Cyrus, you have your hand up.
Well, I just want to also just acknowledge and say outright that this, like, if we're being honest, is like the beginnings of how gentrification happened and how things begin to change. Like, this seems, might seem like a benign step, and is something that to people maybe not in this conversation who haven't thought about the nuance seems like a very like basic and like straightforward thing to enact. But this is the reality of how things change, how people leave, how people are pushed out. And I just want to be like upfront and honest and say that, have that said in all conversations really about this topic, because that's central. And yeah, I guess I just want to say that. But I also want to say that there are the real issues that come up that are also valid and important and need to be addressed. So that also is true.
Okay. So how do we deal with those real and valid issues? I want to hear from some people who haven't spoken yet. If you feel comfortable speaking up, I'm going to call on folks who I see. So Salam, do you want to share anything about your perspectives? And I want people to think about, how do we deal with the issues when they actually do come up, and who should be dealing with those issues?
Sure. Doing laundry, sorry for the noise. Honestly, I don't really have any solution, but I'm speaking from my experience as a mom of children who walks in the lake And I feel like having these meters is just going to impact a lot of families that are already pushed out. And people, you know, my kids go to Cleveland, which is around the lake. But seen over the years, we can see the change in demography and all the status. And how when we are talking about having these meters, people running around, feeding them, being penalized for it, is just going to impact a lot of families that are already struggling. So I'm just here pledging as a person who, you know, has to work jobs and, you know, juggle all this stuff, parenting, school and whatnot, and try to enjoy the lake as, you know, as an Oaklander. So hopefully somebody can advocate for that and solutions. I mean, we can't really have like a lot of penalties and fines as a solution. I think, as you mentioned, there are already a lot of, you know, rules that are at the lake that we could all adhere to. But I don't think having meters is just gonna solve that. It's just gonna push more people away, people that should actually can walk, you know, enjoy the lake. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that. Are there any other individuals who have not spoken? I see Tanisha Cannon, Vivian Romero, Suzette DeGrange, I think I'm saying that correctly, that wanna weigh in and give your perspectives, because I also, you know, we're winding down on our time, but I wanted to do a quick check-in on what do you all think about the report or the suggestion to allow Oakland residents 2 hours of free parking through registering your license plate with the city.
Hi, Carol, I can weigh in.
Thank you.
And you did pronounce my name correctly, so spot on. So I'm a longtime resident of the lake. I've lived here over 20 years. I'm approaching the senior years, which I don't mind saying. I don't own a car and have never owned a car in Oakland. I live in a building with very limited parking. And so I've always used public transportation. And I also have memberships in programs like Zipcar. And the challenge I see with those of us that don't own cars is that when we do step out and say rent a car for a day, it's really difficult to get access to parking. And I'm undecided on the parking meter situation. I really don't know. But I do want to express the concern that some neighbors have who are not car owners, but who from time to time need to access parking. Would the parking meters contribute to more turnover, thereby creating more access? That's, you know, a significant question that I have, because if I can rent a car once a month and have access to a metered parking space on that one day a month I rent a car, it would make a huge difference in my life. And so I just want to put that out there, because again, I don't know the impact of the meters on all of the other issues that were raised tonight, but in terms of accessibility, for those of us with limited income who don't own cars, but who may need access to a car from time to time, the meters might give us a little bit more access than what we have currently. Thank you to everyone for sharing your thoughts tonight. It's been really informative.
Thank you for sharing that. Brianne, I saw your hand up. But you put it down. Did you want to share what you put in the chat for everyone to hear?
No, the way my brain is working, I'm just putting them in the chat, if that's okay. And I also want to say that, like, again, as a Bay Area, well, Oakland native, like, for me, it's just really, really important that like everybody has access to the lake, even those who have been pushed out. Because like, you know, have cousins in Antioch and Pittsburgh and Tracy and all these places because they can't afford to be here anymore. So the 2-hour limit for Oakland residents, like, again, who is that actually going to benefit? And I also want to piggyback on James's suggestion of like something like the macro program before the lake. Like, as a social worker, like, when you have those relationships, when people know who you are, like, you can't be like, oh, like, yo, can you like not smoke weed at the lake right in front of these kids? And like, you're able to have different conversations than the police can. So I would love anything where there are folks from the community having those conversations. But again, I know it's Oakland, like, we don't have money for all this kind of stuff. Right. But I'm very worried about the police interactions with the folks at the lake in particular, because I work with a lot of Black and brown youth. And so that part for me just feels a little scary. So I love James's suggestion of macro, because I'm just as worried about my, you know, students getting shot by each other as I am them getting like roughed up by the police and like going to jail for, you know, something that could have been handled a different way. And so I just want to put all of that out there. It should be accessible to those who've been pushed out. And we also need to think about the residents who, like the folks who come to the lake, who, you know, they are going to listen to their music loudly. You know, it may be cussing or whatever. They may be really loud or whatever it is, but like, that's just part of the culture. Like, I'm not, you know, if they're playing music loud, like, we've been playing music really loud in Oakland forever. So I'm not willing to change the culture of Oakland for, especially for folks who are recent residents and want us to quiet down. And maybe that's just my own feelings around that. But I think we should find a way where folks don't have to interact with the actual police, but can still have some accountability to community members.
I completely agree with that. And so if we could get a community-based solution or parks ambassadors to do that work where they don't, you know, where they can build a rapport with people and do kind of vibe with folks, I think that would be a better solution. It'd be a more affordable solution, a more sustainable solution. But once again, this is Oakland and we do need the resources to be able to pay for that. So there are no easy answers. I'm probably gonna close with that. There are no easy solutions to some of the challenges that we face, but you all are my personal focus group for this evening to help me determine what those solutions should be. So what if there was a hybrid program or a pilot program where we did do, like you said, Princess, and try a paid system for 6 months and have the revenues created from parking go to parking permits for the people who live around the lake, park ambassadors, and to reinvest in park programming. What do you all think about something like that?
So really quickly, I wanted to say, so Pratt did say make it a 1-year pilot.
Okay.
One, because the upfront cost of installing these kiosks is $250,000. Two, parking is seasonal, right? We may see we're going to see an uptick in visitors come the summer months or the warmer days. And so that's why we said, let's run a pilot for a year and see the trends and collect the data every 6 months. So I just wanted to clarify for folks on that. But I would love to hear also how people feel about that. I know Council Member Taylor suggested the first 2 hours free parking. Perhaps it's the first 3 hours. If there is another section of the lake that already has 3 hours of free parking, maybe that's where we start as well. I don't know. I also want to say, like, for some residents, you've raised valid points about the parking permits. We've definitely been discussing that. And we've also been trying to figure out how to do it's called like a parking district, or there's another, Councilwoman Fife probably has better knowledge of it, but that idea of the parking permits for residents has definitely crossed cracks desk, and also trying to consider that as well. And what we've been told so far is that it's not quite possible. So hopefully the councilwoman has more influence in getting to a better decision or a better answer than Pratt. But
I will fight for that. I run into that, being told that a lot about what can't happen. So I'm willing to fight for that. I think if people are living there, I'm confused about why some neighborhoods can have permits and some can't. So once I told Joanna and Kenna that I would circle back on that issue, and I absolutely will. And Princess, I'll include you in that conversation as well. Are there any other, this is, we're just scratching the surface, really. And I wanna thank you all for tuning in and being a part of this conversation. I expect that everyone will weigh in when it comes to council on June 21st, and you don't have to necessarily be on the call, but if you can email my office, I would really, really appreciate it. I would love if you could share just a couple of the questions that were asked today. I will be following up via email with you all just about, you know, helping me to collect my thoughts around this issue as we get closer to the June 21st day. I did see, Brian, that you had your hand up and you put it down really quickly. It looks like Cyrus is in now from his walk around the lake. You did that. Touche. Thank you for being out there for us today. But Brian, did you want to share, or are you complete with your thoughts?
I was just gonna say, like, again, just working with the youth, like, I think there are so many different ways that we can get Oakland residents involved and also have them be some type of ambassadors for the community that does cost a lot less than police, but they can also build these relationships. And it's like, if we want the crime to go down, maybe we should give these kids something else to do. Not even just kids, like, I'm talking like 16 to 24, you know what I mean? And so there are a lot better solutions for crime and for drugs and for all of these things than parking meters. I don't think it's going to solve anything. I think there are a lot better solutions that are more community-based.
Thank you for sharing that. Princess?
Councilwoman, I wanted to jump in here on to Brian's point. I think for park stewards right now, those who have been hired are primarily from the BIPOC community. They are either Oakland natives or have lived in Oakland. So that's our current pool of park stewards. And so we want to keep that trend going. So I hear you on that front. I can say that one of the goals is to make them more community involved and community ambassadors and less on the enforcing side. And the reason why they are not park rangers is because park rangers were armed, and we do not want an extension of OPD, you know, doing this community engagement. I will say that also Joe DeVries's group has been working with the Good Brother Network and Oakland Impact Hub to go out to the lake and do surveys to get a good representation of what community folks, people at the lake, not just those who live by the lake, but those who also love going to the lake, what they're looking for. In terms of park stewards, I've personally have worked with the Good Brother Network and Oakland Impact Hub to do the first town hall about the lake. So those things are forthcoming. We do need a dedicated revenue stream for this program to see it in its full potential. And I think we can think about, I think there are some measures that are getting, I think it's crime prevention funding, Councilwoman Fife. There are some measures. So maybe we can pull money from those areas into park stewards as well, right? Maybe it means we hold off on parking meters and write a new ballot measure for the city that will go towards crime prevention and it segues into park stewards, perhaps. Perhaps that's something we can do. I don't know. I'm just like spitballing because these are things that have come up in a year worth of discussion about the lake. There was something else, Brian, you mentioned, but I can't remember it right now. But so if it comes back to me, I will definitely like raise it and I'll put it in the chat. But I wanted to say those two things for sure that I think we can consider.
Okay, thank you for that, Princess. And James, I think I'm gonna give you the last word.
With regard to a dedicated income stream, I was part of the committee that helped to put Measure Q on the ballot. Measure Q, 60% of Measure Q's funds are specifically for parks maintenance and improvement. And there's 30% that goes to homelessness and 5% to sewer treatment and so forth, and 5% for administration. But the measure is quite specific in how those funds are to be used. The first round of those Measure Q funds is not being used as is called out in the ballot measure. So I think next year and for years going forward, I would like to see PRAC take a more active role in monitoring how Measure Q funds are actually being apportioned, because it's possible that the Measure Q funds could allot a certain amount of that to the measures that have been talked about to improve safety at the lake. One other thing I'd like to say before is, I think San Jose has a program dealing with people who do the, what's it called, the roundies, the circles in the streets. And I think their program might be worth taking a look at, but there could be a way to approach that even with a kind of a humanitarian approach. Warnings in the first instance and maybe fines the second time, and third time is a confiscation of the autos. I think San Jose's program might be worth looking at to deal with the people who are doing the roundies or the circles in the street and also in the park and the motorcycles in the parks. So thank you.
Thank you, James. And thank you, everyone. This is the food for thought that I wanted to glean from not only people who live around the lake, but from people who visit the lake and from family members who don't live in Oakland that come to the lake. I'm trying to get a more rounded and direct response from individuals about what they think. This is a big issue, and it's something I think that we all care about. And what I wanna get to is a place where everyone that's coming to the lake respects the rights of everyone else to enjoy it. And so that's gonna look different, but if we have a common understanding of how we should engage and, you know, we make space for everybody, I think it can happen. And I know it can because it has, right? It's just, you know, we're in some wild times right now, and there's some things we need to get under control. And I think we can do that if we do it thinking more proactively about how we work with our community members, how we work with our vendors, how we engage when people are behaving badly, because really it is a small group of people. It's not a large number of individuals that are coming to the lake creating issues. But you know, when those little issues bubble up, we gotta address them. So once again, I'm not stating any of my opinions outside of that little one that I did a little earlier, but this is really, really helpful for me. And I'm going to turn it over to my chief of staff, Tanya Love, and you can close us out, Tanya.
Yeah, I just really want to thank you guys for participating. This was, you know, wasn't as huge as of a group, but it was great because we were able to get some real good ideas and thoughts in. And so really want to appreciate you taking the time to share with us and share with Councilmember Fife. I did want to close it out. She teased that I would sing, and I'm not going to torture you guys like that and do it, but I did find the song that Princess suggested, and I would like to just close out sharing that song and much in appreciation. You don't have to stay to listen to the whole thing, but just to close out in positivity would be great, so I'm going to play us out. All right, and thank you guys, and have a great evening.
Tomorrow will bring